innocent people? This is the big question, of course, that so many of us ask. A little child is abused by a relative. An elderly person is victimized in a home invasion. A female college student is assaulted on campus. Someone is shot in a robbery. You know, if you watch the evening news or just read the newspaper, it gives detailed litanies, lists of people who have suffered because of evil. Innocent people are violated and really stripped of their dignity. And meanwhile, the perpetrators of evil often get away and even continue to devastate other people's lives. So we would naturally ask, where is God's care in protecting the innocent? Where is God's justice for those who are guilty? We know that God is always there to comfort and to heal and to sustain victims of evil, to assist those who are injured, to be with them on the path of recovery. But the evil remains, and evil acts continue to hurt people. So for each one of us who believes in a loving God and a compassionate God, this frustrating fact challenges our belief in God's compassion and protection. Why does God allow weeds to hurt the wheat? Why doesn't God pull the weeds up before they damage the rest of the wheat? So, the fact of the matter is, there is no answer. We do not know God's mind. We do not understand God's sense of justice. All that we are really told is that God is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, rich in kindness. But we are also reminded that God's justice will be put into effect at some point. So in the meantime, maybe this is an invitation for us to take God's place in confronting evil. Could God be challenging us to become his presence to people who are victims? Could God be challenging us to speak out against injustice of any kind? Maybe we're meant to be the prime movers of God's love for others, feeding the hungry, sheltering the homeless, coming to the rescue of people who are victimized. We can and we should stand up courageously against evil in various ways. And many people, many good people do. Perhaps the most important thing we can do, which is essential, is to pray. Our prayers really can transform the world and can really build up the kingdom of God so that mercy will be operative in our world. Sometimes I think maybe there are not enough people praying for this transformation. I think there are a lot of people who just sit in their homes and complain about how bad things are, but they don't pray for a change of heart. So who really knows why evil remains? In the end, though, according to the parable, God will deal with both the wheat and the weeds. The harvest will be gathered in. Those who are righteous will shine in glory, and those who have embraced evil will suffer the consequences. In the meantime, we do what we must do to be instruments of God's love